This is the one. This is it. This is the fucking podcast of all podcasts. It's the motherfucking Holy Grail. It's like, get the fuck out of here.
Get the fuck out of here.
You know, I think that we'd be shocked if we walked through some of our schools today from USA Today. Today's schools are cursed by an increase in swearing with language that would stand a sailor's hair on end. In a recent poll of high school principals, 89% said they face profane language every day. How sad, Jack. Our teenagers.
You are now listening to the world's stupidest podcast ever. This is the GTFOH podcast. We have no idea what the fuck we're doing.
Oh, I'm running on empty. Yes, I am. I'm running on empty, you bitches. Hello, my friends. How you doing? What's going on? Welcome to the GTFOH podcast. Get the fuck out of here.
Get the fuck out of here.
Episode number 64, Dog Shit Alley. My name is Wrekonize. My friends call me Wreck. It's Billboard Baggins if you're nerdy. It's Billy Baggins if you're nasty. And I want to welcome you back to the show. It's been a fucking minute. I was supposed to be on Valentine's Day, but I didn't fucking make it. Shit was fucked up. Nah. Me and my girl got tickets gifted from a family member that for Andrea Bocelli, the opera... I guess you call him opera singer, right? He's an opera singer. I mean, he does all kinds of shit, but I know he's got the operatic voice. It was not a show that I would have personally purchased tickets for myself, but they was free. And it was Valentine's Day and shit. I was like, yo, let's go. So I didn't really go in expecting much, but the show was fucking fire. The show was amazing. Very inspiring. Super dope. We had a good time. I drank a little too much. I haven't really been drinking that much. And I went in a little hard. I was feeling myself. Valentine's Day. I got that extra double tequila, the second one. I shouldn't have done that. Should have just done the one. And then, we were at the arena in Sunrise, Florida Live Arena, and nothing you can eat at those places are ever good. And I was starving. I didn't eat no dinner, so I had like a double tequila, and then I got another double tequila while I was waiting on the food I ordered. And the only food I could order from the concession stand was a fucking poutine, all right? Which was fucking fire at the time. But I'm pretty sure my body went into some sort of relapse. I don't think I'm supposed to eat that shit. It was fucked up. And then my kids have been sick, you know what I'm saying? My kids have been really, like, all over the sick spectrum. And then, so we did that on Tuesday night. And then last night, I really wasn't feeling well on top of just like juggling everything with the kids and being recovering from the like night out before. Then my kids chose that night to just go completely apeshit and just not sleep at all.
Get the fuck out of here.
So then they was up all throughout the night. One of my kids has got like really bad congestion. So he's like complaining that his brain hurts, which if you're a parent, when you hear your kids say for a few days straight that their brain hurts, I don't know about y'all, but I just get paranoid. I'm like, your brain, what is that? Well, like, what the fuck? Like, I you know what I mean? So I was getting emotional and a little bit freaked out by the whole shit. I think it's just that he's just congested really is what it is, but it's fucking freaking me out. So then we asleep last night. And then, like, in November of last year, I saw that Wicked the Play was coming to Miami. And my wife has always wanted to see that shit for years and years and years now. So I went ahead and bought us tickets. But the best seats I could find was for a matinee on a Thursday afternoon. So we went today at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. But we had just not slept all night last night. So it was fucked up. One of my kids didn't even go to school. You know what I mean? So we was just doing the juggle. And then I was just in Wicked like, oh, this is a very entertaining show. I'm going to pass out in that bitch. Just fucked up. It was a great show. It was cool. It was dope. But yeah, anyway, so this technically, this episode here, Dog Shit Alley, is supposed to be the Valentine's episode. So we have some Valentine's Day themes. A couple of you guys left some Valentine's Day lines and, you know, the such. So basically, like, we're 2 days late, but it's my show, so fuck it, we're gonna do it anyway.
Get the fuck out of here.
Somebody said I could, like, Danny was telling me, yo, just skip it, man. It's cool. Take the week off. And I was like, man, fuck that.
Get the fuck out we're of here.
We're fucking doing it. All right, we're fucking doing it. So we're doing it anyways. It's only right. So I appreciate you guys for tuning in. Shout out to everybody that's live on Twitch right now watching me, my live audience. I fucking love y'all. You guys are the truth. If you're listening to this on a podcast platform, please let me just ask you guys real quick to go ahead and rate the show and do all that jazz. If you're on YouTube, subscribe to the channel. I need all the help I can get. I tried to launch subscriptions last week on our Spotify Anchor platform thing or whatever, and it was like a complete fucking disaster. If people get emails that subscriptions are available, but then if you click that email, it took you absolutely fucking nowhere.
What?
Yeah.
Get the fuck out of here. Are you kidding?
It was a button that didn't do shit. I don't know what's up with that Anchor. I don't know what's up with that Spotify, but there's a link in the show notes, I think should be now, for all the show episodes if you want to become a subscriber. I'm still trying to figure out how the shit works. I might have to take this shit to a whole nother platform. I found a decent one that I think might be better than the one I'm using right now. So anyway, we'll figure that out at some point. But fuck it. I don't give a shit about that right now. It's all about the motherfucking show. All right? Let's go. Shit. All right. Well, basically, it's been a rough couple of days. I don't want to beat around the bush. I want to get straight to the point. I want to see what's out there in this world. And I need to relax, recover, recuperate. So just give me some head. Lines. Getting some head. Lines.
At 11, pay more at the grocer, but getting less will tell you how to get the most.
The fuck are you doing?
We need to acknowledge an unfortunate mistake that I made and one of the teases we bring to you before this program. While we were live just after 10 o'clock, I said a word that many people find offensive. I'm truly sorry. It was a mistake on my part, and I sincerely apologize.
I apologize. I meant to put the world is fucked, why bother sample on this soundboard here, because I really want to start using that again, because the world is pissing me off lately, and I fucking forgot, and just with everything else that was going on, it was one of the last things I was supposed to do, and I didn't add that sound, so I don't fucking have it.
Get the fuck out of here!
But it's cool, you can just imagine it, you know, like, whenever you feel like it should be in the show, just imagine it in your mind, that I'm triggering it, and then it'll just be fine, and then we'll edit it in, fix it in post, or we'll put it in on the next episode, or whatever. The world is completely fucked. I was gonna give you guys some real severe news. I wanted to talk about the earthquake for a little minute, and all the shit that's been affecting, you know, how, like, the crazy insane death toll, the fucked up response, all that shit. We could go into detail there. Apparently at the moment, my brain just can't even handle that severe information. What I will say is, real quick, before we move on to our style of news, basically, for the next 10 days from today, the 16th of February, to the 26th of February, if you get a Cameo from me, I don't know if you're familiar with Cameo. It's like a video shout out thing where you can get like a drop or sing happy birthday to your grandma, or tell your boss to suck your balls or whatever. I could do any of that for you. And as of right now, for the next 10 days, any Cameos that come my way, 100% of the profits and proceeds will go to an organization called Choose Love, which are raising money for people affected by the earthquakes in Turkey and Syria. So if you want to go ahead and check it out, cameo.com/Wrekonize. All the proceeds for the next 10 days are going towards Choose Love. So that's about as much as my brain will allow me to say in terms of some real shit and some serious shit going on in the world. But this show is really not for that. But I just had to get that out of the way real quick. All right, let's do this. Let's where are we starting tonight? Okay. Like I said, this is the Valentine's Day episode, all right? And, oh man, speaking of choose love, sometimes I think, like, I need signs from the world. I think we all need signs from the world. And on Valentine's Day, this story coming up is the perfect example that you need to pay attention, because love can conquer all.
They say what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Such is the case for an Allentown couple whose romance made headlines 40 years ago before hitting the silver screen.
69 News reporter Jackie Ferris introduces us to the Totos, who know a thing or two about love and forgiveness.
Wow.
It's an unusual gallery.
Everything you see is a memory.
About a very unusual but happy couple.
It's a love story.
This year, Tony and Frances Toto will celebrate 57 years of marriage.
We've been blessed that we are together all these years. There was a one time when we had some rough time.
When Tony says they had a rough time, he's putting it mildly. The year was 1983. Tony and Frances had four kids and a pizza shop. But then Tony strayed from the marriage and Frances found out.
So you decided you were going to kill your husband.
Oh, yeah.
What happened next was like something out of a movie.
It's the pizza man.
Pizza man.
Hollywood thought so too, turning the Toto's troubles into a feature film called I Love You to Death. While not everything in the movie is accurate, Frances did hire teenage hitmen to help her try to kill Tony five times, including failed attempts to blow up his car and attack him with a baseball bat. One night, Frances put a bottle of sleeping pills in Tony's food, and then the hitmen shot him.
Twice, one in the back of my head and one... And then the bullet went right through the chest.
Goddamn.
And the one in his head is still there.
Goddamn.
I don't think I was thinking straight.
You think?
It was like a love-hate kind of a thing.
Because of the pills, Tony's system slowed down. He was in a daze and says he didn't feel a thing, believing Frances when she told him he had the flu. After 5 days, police found out about the plot and arrested Frances and the teenage hitman. Tony spent 12 days in the hospital. The first thing he did when he was discharged was bail out Frances.
And then we both cry and we said, to each other, you know, for now on, let's talk, let's communicate better. Something that we should have done before.
You think?
So that's what was missing.
Tony and Frances say that tearful moment was a new beginning for their relationship, and to help them stay on track, they got counseling.
Did I forgive her? Yes, nothing happened to me. Yes, that's okay. Don't do it again, Fran. Take it easy, yeah?
No.
But Frances had to pay for what she did, spending 4 years in prison, talking to Tony on the phone every day. Then in 1990, a silver lining to their dark cloud, I Love You to Death hit theaters.
And Siskel and Ebert give it two thumbs up.
Tony and Frances traveled to movie premieres around the world and were featured in thousands of newspaper and magazine articles.
I was not happy about that gun over there. I'll make sure it was empty.
40 years later, things are much quieter. Tony assembled this gallery as proof that, like the headline says, love can conquer all.
That's a nice coffee over there. What about espresso coffee, eh?
The couple says they know their situation is one in a million, and many people won't agree with it or understand it. And while they stop talking publicly about what happened long ago...
If we could help one or two family, it's worth it.
They wanted to share their story now as an extreme example of the importance of communication in a marriage. Jackie Ferris, 69 News.
And once again, as Jackie pointed out, the Totos are an unusual situation that happened 40 years ago. So if you or a loved one's being abused or you're afraid for your safety, help is available. You
can dark turn. They're really going to put the National Domestic Violence Hotline up after that.
Call the National Domestic Violence Hotline at 800-799-SAFE, 799-SAFE. It's 800-799-7233. You can also chat with someone anonymously at thehotline.org.
Get out of here.
Wow. All right. One time for love conquering all, folks. Yo, what the fuck is going on? They've been together for 52 years, all right? That's insane. I know some couples breaking up and getting in and out of relationships on the regular, and these people have been through some shit. Like, this is definitely the most extreme case. 52 years. 40 years ago, she tried to kill him. 1983, I think they said. Holla, 1983. The year I was born. 39 years, almost 40 years ago. She said, nah, fuck that. All I know is this bitch is useless. She tried five times. Who did she hire? Who are these hitmen that she hired? Holy shit. she hired the dumbest kids ever because they couldn't get the job done. Then she put sleeping pills in his food or whatever, and he got drugged up, and they attacked him and shot him twice, and he still fucking survived?
Get the fuck out of here.
This dude wouldn't die. Did you see the news clippings that they posted up there? One of them, she was holding a gun to his head. Epic. Epic story. So that's just a little Valentine's Day inspiration for you, because if you're having trouble with your spouse, you know what I mean? Just be like, yo, we could be like the Totos or whatever the fuck their name was, because we could be on some shit and you could be trying to kill me five fucking times.
Get the fuck out of here.
That was an amazing story to kick it off. One time for love. Everybody make some noise for love, if you would, please. Oh, man. All right, well, either way, some of you aren't going to be that lucky. Some of you might not be able to, have someone trying to kill you. They love you so much. But at least if they don't try to kill you, they could give you the pickle.
Whether it's a dill ball or a dead ball, it's the sound of that ball that has neighbors up in arms.
These courts, probably 50 feet from my doorstep. I can hear all of the action in my bedroom in the back of the house.
Mary McKee lives across the street from the Walter Reed Community Center tennis courts that, as of late, have become the hotspot for pickleball players across the area.
We've got more people coming, more people playing, more people wanting to play.
Vaughn lives in Annandale and has been playing since the summer. He says he gets that the noise might be a nuisance for some.
Hear this pick-pock of the pickleball. I don't know if it's, irritating for some, but for us, it's great.
He and the others say they follow the rules, only playing during the hours permitted, 7 a.m. to 10 p.m.
That works in the Walter Reed Center. Tells us to stop at 10 o'clock. He'll come out and be like, everyone out, like right now.
Those neighbors I spoke with who are upset about this say it's not that they're anti-pickleball. It's just that they want some guidelines put in place.
We're not against the sport of pickleball. We want you to have fun. We want you to go out and exercise. We want you to be with your friends.
McKee says the hours need to be shortened, that something should be done to block out the sound, and that the number of pickleball courts should be spread out.
We've got 80 plus tennis courts available across the county that could be dual purpose.
The players offered some suggestions.
If someone's able to create a paddle that's like, noise canceling or whatever, like I'll be down for that.
Maybe put in some sound walls here.
McKee says she and her neighbors have spoken to the county about this a number of times. Now they're considering taking legal action if changes aren't made. In Arlington, Katie Lasso, WUSA 9.
Get the fuck out of here!
Yes. Damn. She is upset. My girl is upset. She was not feeling that shit. Can we just talk about pickleball for a split second? All right. Why the fuck did they call it pickleball?
Get the fuck out of here.
I don't understand. Like, they got a serious news report. This is a serious, they're trying to be serious story. How is anybody keeping a straight face when the shit is called pickleball?
Get the fuck out of here.
Can somebody school me to the origin of pickleball? Like, how exactly did this sport that looks kind of like a mixture between tennis and ping pong and maybe like badminton or something become called pickleball?
Get the fuck out of here.
And it sounds like when you open a jar of pickles when they hit the ball. It does sound very loud. It does kind of sound like that, actually, now I think about it. From that video, it does sound a little bit like a jar of pickles opening. That can't be why they're opening it, though. Yeah, like, it's, why not paddleball? I mean, I guess paddleball's already a thing, right? You know what I'm saying? Paddleball's already a sport. Pickleball. I just don't fucking get it. All I want to know is, anybody in the GTFOH community, are you playing pickleball? Have you played pickleball? Is it fun? Everyone raves about this shit. LeBron James has put a bunch of money into pickleball. I just want to know, is pickleball, am I missing out? Do I need to fucking get involved in pickleball? I don't really get involved with sports. I'm too lazy. But am I missing out on a fun time with pickleball?
Get the fuck out of here.
I'm just saying. Please let me know. Send me a message. Talk to me. Let me know what's going on. If I'm missing out pickleball, I need to know. I need to know about it, like ASAP. All right, let's go from the pickleball courts to the latest cutting edge anti-theft technology. All right. If you go to the pickleball court and play, you might be worried about your vehicle or anything inside of it. I got a brand new method for you. They should have been covering this in the CES convention or whatever, because this is some shit I was like, damn, why did I think of that? This is amazing. This dude really like reinvented the whole like anti-theft situation. Bloomington, Indiana. A man accused of arson told Bloomington police that he set his car on fire to discourage people from stealing from it.
Get the fuck out of here!
Police responded to a report of a suspicious person just after midnight in the parking lot of the Crawford Apartments on South Henderson Street on February 12th. An officer said he found a man standing next to a 1998 Buick that was on fire.
Get the fuck out of here!
I'm gonna just repeat that for you. He was trying to prevent someone from stealing from his 1998 Buick.
Get the fuck out of here!
So he set it on fire. The man, identified as Austin Bristos, is 26 years old, reportedly told an officer the vehicle was his and he set it on fire to stop people from stealing items inside of it. I need to find out the drugs this man is on because I've been having a rough week. I'm thinking I might fucking try it.
Get the fuck out of here.
As police were talking to Bristow, the car became engulfed in flames. There you go, that'll teach him. And the fire caused several small explosions. At one point, Bristow reportedly said, I kind of hope the explosions would be bigger, as he watched the vehicle burn.
Get the fuck out of here.
Court documents state Bristow started the fire by cutting the fuel line, goddamn, dumping gas and oil onto the car and setting a bandana on fire and then throwing it into the trunk. Libertad!
Get the fuck out of here.
Austin then stated that if there was nothing left of the vehicle, then there would be nothing left to steal. If I can't have it, nobody can have it. Fuck these people. Police arrested Bristow on a preliminary charge of arson. When searching him, they found several packed syringes, there it is, and a yellow powder he identified as benzodiazepine. I don't know how to say that. He was then booked on arson plus additional charges of unlawful possession of a syringe, hypodermic needle, and controlled substance, which brings me to my next point, folks. Don't smoke crack.
Get the fuck out of here.
Come on. So just in case you guys are going out, Valentine's Day weekend or whatever, President's Day next, you're going to go out on President's Day, just try the new, brand new, you know, like Detective by Viper, stand back. Well, no, we got a better one than that. Just set your whole car on fire, all right? They will not steal anything from your car. They won't steal your car for sure, and they won't steal anything out of your car if everything's on fire.
Get the fuck out of here!
Just dropping gems on you people. Free gems. You're not even subscribed. all right. Oh, God. This is where the world is fucked. Why bother would come in so handy. Let's check in on the... Okay, since we're going from the cutting edge in anti-theft technology, let's go over to Japan and check the cutting edge hygienic practices. Why? Don't do it. No, he's gonna lick the... Ah, yeah, he's just licking the whole bowl. Why? What's wrong with this little fucker? Ew, he's fingering the sushi rice. Get the fuck
out of here. Get the fuck out of here.
No, and then not the thumbs up at the end. Oh, Jesus Christ. What the fuck? What is wrong with this world? Licking things at sushi train restaurants is the latest viral Japanese trend. In case you didn't know, this video comes to us from Tokyo, where whoever the fuck this BTS looking motherfucker is licking this little teeny bopper looking boy is licking communal soy sauce bottles and spitting on people's sushi rolls. And he's slurping spoons in communal bowls and laughing into the camera. These pranksters were looking to go viral at conveyor belt sushi restaurants and have become the buzziest topic on Japanese social media this past week. Their videos have each generated millions of views and have sparked so much outrage and disgust that a new term is trending. Sushi Tero, which is short for sushi terrorism.
Get the fuck out of here!
These sushi terrorists, they gotta pay. I love sushi. This video upset me. All right, these sushi terrorists, this is high-level terrorism. Like, it's in the top three of terrorism that we should be concerned about. Such scenes would elicit disgust anywhere, but they've set off a national wave of revulsion in Japan, of course, known for its exacting standards of both hygiene and politeness. Fuck yeah. This week, Sushiro, which is a conveyor belt sushi restaurant chain where one of the most viewed recent videos was filmed, took the rare step of submitting a complaint to the police about a boy. Well, it is a boy. We weren't sure in the chat if that was a boy or a girl. He does have kind of like the bobby, you know, like it kind of be like maybe a, you know, unisex haircut, but no, it's a boy. They took the rare step of submitting a complaint to the police about a boy who licked unused cups and soy sauce bottles and touched other people's sushi after licking his fingers, because why?
Get the fuck out of here!
The video, taken in an outlet in the central province of Gifu, has generated tens of millions of views since it hit the internet, because TikTok ain't shit. And people are telling me that they're like programming TikTok to like brainwash us. And my debate recently with my friends that have been telling me this is, are you sure like it's them programming us, or it's just a reflection of how fucked up and stupid our society is that we just love to watch dumb shit?
Get the fuck out of here!
Like people licking sushi bowls and shit. You know what I'm saying? Sushiro's decision to pursue civil and criminal actions came as a surprise. The boy, whose age was not disclosed, but he looks about all of but 14, and his parents apologized to the restaurant, but the restaurant claimed it has suffered reputational and financial damage. Its stock fell by 5%. Damn, their stock? Or nearly $125 million. Holy shit. What kind of sushi place is this? I think it's a chain, that's why. That's a fucking... They're making a lot of money. Holy shit. Damn. Viral prank videos on social media are hardly new, and there have been many incidents like this in the recent years. Apparently this is the hot shit, but the police complaints have led to a debate on social media about whether taking legal action against the pranksters, some of whom are minors, is a step too far.
Get the fuck out of here!
No! These are sushi terrorists! You know what I'm saying? What do you mean? Is this too far? Of course it's not too far. Fuck that shit. So let those people that think it's too far, I would like you to go into this restaurant, enjoy your meal, have a great sushi dinner. You know what I'm saying? Just really soak it all in. Yummy, delicious. And then let me bring in Boy Wonder over here and be like, oh, just by the way, he spit in all this shit. He rubbed his balls on the fucking, on the wasabi. You know what I mean? And then be like, how do you feel about this? You don't want to take legal action, right? You just want to you really shouldn't have done that. You know what I'm saying? I don't know. How would you feel about it if it was you? I feel like people watching on the internet are like, no, it's not that serious. You eat the fucking shit then. You eat the meal. All right? In another video originally posted on back in January, someone puts wasabi on sushi rolls as the plate makes its way along the conveyor belt to the intended customer. Aside from such nuisance videos filmed at restaurants, there have been other troubling videos in recent weeks of Japanese TikTokers harassing homeless people for views, which have similarly sparked outrage online. Basically, these Japanese kids are fucking up.
Get the fuck out of here!
What will they strike next? Shit. All right. Shit. Well, fuck them. I don't know what to do. I slapped the shit out of that kid, too. Absolutely. Fuck that kid. Fuck that. That's disgusting. Come on, man. Where do we draw the line? You know what I mean? I'm saying corporal punishment or civil punishment. I feel like cut his tongue out. You know what I'm saying?
Get the fuck out of here.
Is that a step too far? Take it back to the medieval days on that motherfucker. All right. From Tokyo, we're going to come to... Let's go over the pond, but not all the way back. We're going to go to Merseyside, somewhere in the UK. The title track of our episode, if you will. Frustrated Merseyside locals have renamed their street due to frustrations with the amount of dogs taking large shits on their street. Now, apparently, the new street's name is Dog Shit Alley.
Get the fuck out of here!
Goddamn right. A street on Merseyside has been rechristened Dog Shit Alley by locals who are fed up with having to dodge piles of dog excrement every time they leave their homes. An anonymous artist created a crude cardboard road sign to express their frustration with the area's dog fouling problem. Oh, they didn't really change the name. That's not like... It's like some... This is like some bootleg Banksy shit. One person living in the area who did not want to be named for fear of repercussions spotted the sign on his travels and said he agreed with the sentiment. That's right. This is bullshit. This is dog shit. The man said the issue of dog fouling in and around the park has been going on for years. Apparently, the man claims people also take their pets in an area of the park which is fenced off for children to play in, despite signs which read, no dogs allowed. He added streets surrounding the park are also covered in dog shit.
Get the fuck out of here!
He added that people are riding through there on their bikes. If you have a stroller, you're hardly able to miss it, and that goes into houses and everywhere. I've had dogs taking shits in my drive, and it's all along the pavement from the junction of Church Road. Hey, Church Road, what's up? Make some noise for Church Road. This is right where I was born, right where I used to live. To Seymour Street to all the way around to the park. I didn't realize it was that neighborhood for real. That's tight. Well, apparently, whenever you listen to my song Church Road on my album The War Within, you can now just call it Dog Shit Alley.
Get the fuck out of here!
This is the Genesis, this is Dog Shit Alley. Alright, apparently, dog fouling is an offense, and the local authority has the power to issue a fixed penalty notice if someone is caught in the act by an enforcement officer. But judging by the recent news on our last episode, where a boy set fire to a farm causing 1 million pounds in damage, and he only got fined 61 pounds, aka like $55 or $59 or some shit like that, I'm pretty sure no one's gonna get fouled or fined for leaving a big deuce. A big doggy deuce.
Get the fuck out of here!
On Dog Shit Out. Alright. So just in case you guys didn't know, it's free game over there in Church Road. This is the Genesis. This is Dog Shit Alley. Alright. Alright, I'm glad I don't live in Dog Shit Alley anymore. Make some noise for that. I moved! I moved from Dog Shit Alley to a place called Florida.
Okay, so I think you should use this idea for your Florida segment and get the out of here. So I came up with get on the Florida, because when the cops come arrest you with their handcuffs, they're like, get on the floor so that they can put the handcuffs on. And since it's about Florida and all the crazy stuff that happens there, which is usually involved with the cops, so get on the Florida is Florida. And also get on Florida. I mean, get on the floor. So I think you should use it because I'm smart. Get on the floor.
Oh, it's good to be home. It's good to be home. I don't live on Dog Shit Alley anymore. I live in a place called Florida. Florida has been fucking, let me just tell y'all. I know we're about to talk a whole mess of shit about my state and talk all these crazy stories. You know what I mean? But Florida has been fucking amazing. Weather-wise, for the last few days, I went to Costa Rica for a May Day show past weekend, and the weather was very nice there. And then I was talking all this shit about how much I loved it, and I feel like when I got back, I feel like Miami was low-key jealous a little bit. Miami was like, what?
Get the fuck out of here.
What the fuck's wrong with you? Like, this is paradise. You went over there talking all this shit about Puta Vida, Costa Rica and shit. No, you need to relax. Because Florida is where it's at. And these last couple days, even though I've been exhausted, kids sick, everything, all this bullshit's been bogging me down, the weather is just fucking glorious here. I'm sorry. I know some of y'all are into wintry weather out there. I'm just trying to send you some heat. You know what I'm saying? Just got to let you guys know. Because we're about to talk shit about Florida. That Florida's beautiful right now. I just want to fucking say it. That's all. Wait a second. Hold on a minute. Let me see what's going on here. Hold on. I'm going to rearrange this because I just said the weather is beautiful, but I just looked right now and I think it might be snowing in Florida.
Tonight, we're getting some new details after the arrest of a Palm Bay City Council member accused of riding his motorcycle while impaired and carrying drugs in his shoe. News 6's James Sparvero has the latest.
Councilman Filiberto?
Here.
Peter Filiberto, seen at the February 2nd Palm Bay City Council meeting. 9 days later, police say officers find 10 grams of cocaine in the councilman's socks after the 34-year-old, speeding on his motorcycle, ran stop signs through the Palm Bay Colony neighborhood. From inside her home, Peggy Russell says she could hear the pursuit.
We frequently have cars that are zooming through, but that one was going really fast.
Police say Filiberto stopped fleeing when he fell off his bike trying to make a U-turn. Police say Filiberto's license was suspended in September, and he was also arrested for DUIs in 2008 and 2019.
Filiberto is now out on bond, but no one answered the door at his home. Also Monday, police told us it would not be releasing body camera video at this time.
Under the law, if prosecutors file charges, Governor DeSantis could suspend Filiberto. He would then be removed from office if convicted or if he pleads guilty or no contest.
I'm so sorry to hear about it because he is a great kid.
Gloria Ferrante is Filiberto's neighbor. She continues to be his supporter, but says she's very concerned about the allegations.
Do you think this could ruin his political career?
I hope not, but probably. To me, he had a great future ahead of him.
Palm Bay's next city council meeting is Thursday. In Palm Bay, Brevard County, I'm James Sparbero, getting results news 6.
So we got a statement from city officials saying in part, quote, the city will continue to cooperate with all involved agencies to ensure a transparent and appropriate process is followed regarding this matter. We'll continue to follow up on this story. Check for updates at clickorlando.com.
Oh my God, Pete Filiberto, look at this motherfucker. This dude looks like if Nicolas Cage was playing a cocaine, like coked out Palm Bay councilman, it would be Pete Filiberto.
Get the fuck out of here.
It looks like this dude screams, I'm on cocaine. Look at this fucking guy's picture. Holy shit. His neighbor Gloria, bless her soul, bless her little cotton socks, as my mother would say, because she has a terrible judge of character. Right?
Get the fuck out of here.
Gloria, I want to tell you something. Records are showing that that arrest right there was Filiberto's third time getting a DUI charge.
Get the fuck out of here.
Holy shit, I'm pretty sure this guy has a real problem, all right? Bright future, my fucking ass. Palm Bay City Council member Pete Filiberto arrested Saturday night on charges of riding his motorcycle while impaired and carrying a whole fucking 10 grams of cocaine in his shoe. Filiberto is 34 years old. He was elected to office in 2022. He was charged with possession of cocaine, reckless driving, DUI alcohol, no motorcycle endorsement, and refusing a DUI test because fuck that, man. The powdered cocaine was found after Filiberto was taken to the police department's holding cell in order to remove his shoes. Court records show that the arrest was Filiberto's third on DUI charges. Palm Bay police say Filiberto, whose address was listed as being in Surfside in Miami-Dade County, was stopped by officers at about 11:50 p.m. on Saturday night on Lipscomb Street in Palm Bay. He was booked into the Brevard County Jail and later bonded out before going to court. Police say he then sped away and attempted to make a U-turn to ride away, but he lost control and fell fucking over. And Gloria, I just want to let you know that I'm so sorry. You are a horrible judge of character, and Filiberto is definitely a coke addict.
Get the fuck out of here!
Sorry to tell you. I don't know what else to say, but yeah, reckless driving. God damn, he did it. Filiberto, what was he thinking? Shit. All right, there you go. So, like I said, the weather's beautiful here, but apparently there is a bit of snow on the ground. Filiberto, so disappointed in you. Really, the biggest crime that he committed was breaking Gloria's heart.
Get the fuck out of here!
Look at Gloria, she was so devastated. She was like, he's a great kid. He brings me peanut butter sandwiches in the afternoon. He's a lovely boy. Gloria, Filiberto is a fucking drug addict. All right, I'm sorry to tell you. This is fucked up. Council member. Shit. All right. Well, they're saying in the chat that cocaine's not even a real drug. All right. I don't know. Excuse me. All right. I mean, I'm from Miami. I get it. Cocaine's everywhere. But come on, man. Like, shit. At least be slick with your shit. Don't get 3 DUIs, man. You're a fucking council member.
Get the fuck out of here.
Fuck out of here. I don't get it. What's happening here? What's going on? Oh, well. What are you going to do? All right, let's do this. Let's do this, because I just rearranged the whole shit. I'm going to have to fucking do some things real quick. The roads in Florida, if it's not going to be skiing and snow that you need to worry about, it's going to be wet out there on these fucking streets, if you didn't know. We're going to go to Cape Coral. Cape Coral is home to some very special characters, if you didn't know, here on Get on the Florida.
Get on the Florida.
Just before midnight, February 8th, Lee County Sheriff's deputies drove north on Chiquita Boulevard. That's a real street name, by the way. As they approached Gleason Parkway, something caught their eye. It was a black Mercedes-Benz parked in the opposite lane. Very suspicious. The vehicle was just sitting there, lights on, with no traffic causing the stoppage. Deputies crept behind the car, flicked on their flashing lights, and tried to determine if the vehicle might have been abandoned. Seems like it might have been an abandoned car. As they approached the vehicle, they found 40-year-old Michael Serrata sitting alone in the passenger seat. Beer cans littered the vehicle's floor and lined the front cup holders. He was getting it in. 24 packs of Michelob Ultra and Bud Light were torn into and drained as casualties were visibly scattered at Sarita's feet. Deputies attempted to begin a line of dialogue, but according to the arrest report, Sarita was, quote, unable to speak due to his level of intoxication. He was fucked up. Now in need of support, Cape Coral's police assistance was requested and the deputy waited for backup. In plain view of the deputies, Sarita reached into the pile of fallen aluminum soldiers. they went in on this. This is another poetic-ass journalist. He reached into the pile of fallen aluminum soldiers and pulled out a hidden treasure, an unopened beer. Deputies, deciding Sarita had clearly reached his limit, declared it was the last call and reached out to remove the hoppy beverage. At the risk of spilling his beer, Sarita began to fight back until deputies were able to remove him from the vehicle. This man was being stopped for potential DUI, and he went ahead and cracked himself a fucking brew.
Get the fuck out of here.
Give some fucking props to this guy. Even the security of handcuffs did little to dispel Sarita's growing aggressions. At one point, deputies used their taser to subdue the agitated opponent, but the taser had zero effect.
Get the fuck out of here.
This man is impenetrable. That's how I was wondering, you know, like how many licks does it take to get to the center of a Tootsie Pop? I always wondered how many Michelob Ultras does it take to become impenetrable by a taser? And this man apparently has fucking cracked the case. All right. They tried to tase this man and it had, quote, zero effect when striking Sarita's back. They tased him in the back and he said, fuck you doing? What the fuck's going on? Deputies resorted to physically restraining Sarita until their support came to back them up. This was quite the traffic stop here. This is Cape Coral. We're either skiing over there in Palm Bay, or if not, we are cracking a cold one, all right, and becoming impenetrable to fucking tasers.
Yeah, on the Florida.
Make some fucking noise for Florida. Starting off strong. He's the Terminator. Hell no. You find out he's the motherfucking Terminator. All right, I see you, Sammy. I see you, bro. All right, let's see, where are we going next? Because I got all out of order. Oh, shit, I forgot to tell you guys. So, for Valentine's Day, right, you guys, what did you guys get your loved one? Did you, you know, did you do a box of chocolates? Did you do, like, edible panties? You know what I mean? Take them to Andrea Bocelli? You know what I mean? Took them out for a dinner at Applebee's? Like, what'd you do? Well, the folks over in Osceola County, which I think is near Orlando, if I'm not mistaken, they want to know, want to let you know that there is something, if you're looking for something, you know, for your, maybe next Valentine's Day, since we're doing this episode late, they have a great idea. Maybe, if you like, you can turn in your ex or your current spouse or significant other in and get them arrested for a outstanding warrant, maybe?
Get the fuck out of here!
This ad was put on to the Osceola County Sheriff's Office. Got an ex who bugs and sells illegal drugs? Oh, I guess this is targeted mainly at ex-boyfriends and girlfriends. If you got an ex who buys and sells, I said bugs. You got an ex who buys and sells illegal drugs or has warrants? Well, we want you to give them a Valentine's Day surprise, all right? We would love to meet with them and treat them to a Valentine's Day surprise, which is what they wrote on their Facebook page. And then they put the crime line anonymous hotline. This is the one of those perfect examples of terrible fucking terrible marketing by the sheriff's department.
Get the fuck out of here.
Put your ex behind bars on Valentine's Day. No, for real. Look, I just want to say out there to all my exes or whatever, like, I know I might have fucked you up a little bit, or, you know, I might have crossed the line or may have disrespected you in some sort of way, but just wanted to let you know, don't you ever think of fucking turning me into the fucking Sheriff Marcos Lopez at the Osceola County.
Get the fuck out of here.
Don't even fucking think about it. I'm clean. I'm fucking clean. All right, so there you go. Just want to let you guys know, if you want to turn in your exes, you can do it. That's the information. Just, I guess they have to be in Florida. I don't know how that works. I guess Osceola County. Good luck with all that, all right? That's all I got to tell you. All right, what else do we have here? Oh, I gotta say, shout out to Eric Wenzel for submitting the sushi story. Yep. And shout out to Denny Gagne for submitting the Cocaine Councilman. Make some noise for Denny, yes. Thank you, thank you. If you want to submit a story, don't forget, you can email me, thegtfohpodcast@gmail.com. Send me any links. If you got some weird local news, that'd be the shit. If you see some weird videos on YouTube, some weird news stories, send them my way. Holla at your boy. It's only right. All right. Okay, so where are we going here? I think we got a couple more stories to cover before we move on here. In Florida, we have, we have another one. Denny sent me another story that I had to research to see, get some information on, okay? It was in Flagler County, okay? And while I was researching for this story, I came across a wonderful chef's kiss, delightful piece of content on the Facebook page of this sheriff's office. So I think, I'm hoping this can become a recurring segment. Let's check in. Let's check in with this new segment and see what we got here.
I'm Flagler County Sheriff Rick Staley bringing you this week's weekend roundup.
So I just broke in with a knife.
Through what, the back door?
Yeah, through the back door. It's all on the security camera, I'm sure.
Yeah, we never watched it.
What was your intention by leaving your card behind?
So that I could come back later and pay for it.
Okay.
Just so they knew my name, you know? Just in case I got picked up. I didn't want to steal anything, you know, that's against the law.
Oh. Yeah.
I don't know if they teach you guys that.
Sit here. I asked you how much narcotics are in the vehicle. You didn't even want to
answer
that.
I don't have any narcotics in the vehicle.
I said, I asked you why you smell like weed, and you're like, you just sat there and stared at me.
Right, I mean.
And then when I asked how much you had, you didn't say anything. How much, what am I going to find when I search the vehicle?
You're not going to find anything.
Perfect then.
I don't know, man. It's really bad.
That was Sheriff Rick Staley's weekend roundup. Can we make that a thing? Can we do that every week? I just want to see Sheriff Rick Staley's weekend roundup. Here's all the scumbags in Flagler. Really, the first story is the one we're focused on. Look at this guy. This guy, he was just, his clip was just amazing. Authorities arrested a Florida man who they said broke into a convenience store and took a few items, although he left his debit card behind.
Get the fuck out of here!
In a video, Flagler County Sheriff Rick Staley posted to Facebook, this is Sheriff Rick Staley's weekend roundup. The suspect told deputies he left his debit card so that he could come back later and pay for the items he took. I didn't want to steal anything, you know, that's against the law. This guy said, I don't know if they teach you guys that. This guy is smart as hell. Deputies responded to an alarm at a closed Palm Coast gas station in the early morning of February 5th. The store owner showed deputy surveillance video, and they also located a debit card with the suspect's name on it.
Get the fuck out of here.
Come on, man. What the fuck? What are you doing? The deputies actually recognized the man in the video from a vehicle fire near the gas station earlier that night. This dude was putting in work. He must have really wanted those items to break into a closed convenience store to get them, Staley said. Leaving a debit card behind does not absolve you from theft or committing a burglary. It does help us, however, find your stupid fucking ass.
Get the fuck out of here.
Deputy said they tracked the man down to return the debit card and arrest him for burglary and theft. All right. Look at this dude's fucking shit. It was amazing. They did say the officers did tell him in the chat, Gridlock saying they lied to him and said they didn't see the video. But I heard them say, we seen the video. We know that you whatever. That's what I heard. I'm gonna have to bring that back. But that mugshot right there is everything. If you're listening to this on Spotify and you're not watching the video right now, I just need you to just pop in real quick, turn your phone sideways, check the video, because that fucking mugshot is epic. Epic mugshot. Oh, Florida. Amazing. Amazing, amazing. Oh, God. All right. The weather was good. It was a vibe. It was great. Wonderful stories out there. Florida's just getting crazier by the day. I love it. The world is fucked. Why bother? I'm going to get that sample on for the show next week. All right. Let's see what else we can do tonight. We have our good friend Spencer from Idaho, a.k.a. Spencer from Earth, back this week. Last week, he did a breakdown of his personal favorite verse of mine from 2022. He rated them all. And I said to him, like, oh, it might be a little bit different, you know, the verses versus the songs, because some people were talking about certain records. So I think he's back this week to remedy that and complete the cipher. First, he did verses. This week, I think it's going to be judged the entire record. Let's see what he's got to say. Spence, it's on you.
You'll recognize it's Spencer here, biggest fan. I've seen every single episode of the podcast. Hey, recognize Spencer here, a longtime caller. I've been calling him for years.
My two Spence. It's my two Spence. My two Spence.
Oh, you got an opinion? Oh, you can't have it, because it's my two Spence.
Spence, yeah.
What is up, y'all? Spencer from Earth here, ready for another segment. Last week, I went over what I thought was Wrekonize's best verse of 2022. Wrek mentioned in the segment doing the my favorite Wrekonize song, or, you know, song with Wrekonize in it, of 2022. So that's exactly what I did, because I have trouble coming up with new segments. So this is that segment now. Okay, here we go. So here's the list right here. I won't keep you in suspense. You can see it right here. If you're listening in on the podcast, I have a list of every single song that Wrekonize was in throughout 2022. So I also included songs where he only sings the chorus. I think there's only two of those, though. I didn't include the Patreon freestyles. Decided to kind of separate those from songs. And yeah, this is the list right here. I'll read them out to you if you're listening in on the podcast. Number five was Cloud Nine with Wax, Mayday, and Bumpin' Uglies. I gave that a 7.5. This rating is basically just my enjoyment of the song. There's some consideration to, you know, the lyrics, the flow, the meaning, the emotion. I really like catchiness, so, you know, was the song catchy? Stuff like that, but for the most part, it's just my enjoyment of the song, okay? So, number five, Cloud Nine, Wax, Mayday, Bumpin' Uglies, 7.5, okay? Number four, Own Way by Mayday and K. Charles, I gave it an 8 out of 10, okay? These next ones are technically tied at 8 out of 10s. I don't know if they're necessarily in an order, but here you go. Number three is Freeway, that was Wrekonize's song. I gave that an 8 out of 10. Number two was Make a Wave by... It's either Zoe or Zoo, I don't know. Zoe 817, Lachey Love, and Mayday. I gave that an 8 out of 10 as well. And then in the number one spot, Someone to Save, DJ Hoppe, and Wrekonize. That was also in my top five for Wrekonize verses. So not too surprising to see that up there. Overall, thought it was a great song. You can see the rest of the list right here if you're watching. If you're listening, then sorry, you got to go to YouTube or... I think on Spotify we have the video now. I don't know how that works, but this is the list. Towards the bottom, the last place spot, my least favorite song of 2022 that has Wrekonize in it was Verses in My Head by Authentic. I wasn't a big fan of that song. These bottom three or four right here are pretty songs. Didn't really enjoy listening to them too much. You can see there's a lot bigger of a kind of range with these songs in terms of the rating. You have some high ratings and you got some low ratings. You got everything in between. So a little more mixed or diversified of ratings this time. If you're wondering, Spencer, what's a 10 out of 10? A 10 has to be like it shifts my perspective on the art form in some way. Okay, so, you know, a 10 out of 10 movie would be something like Fight Club, where... Every movie I watch in some way gets compared to Fight Club, and just Fight Club has shifted the way I view a movie, right, and the way I think about a movie, or Pulp Fiction, right? In terms of music, The Hangover by Mayday is a song I might give a 10 out of 10 to. So, A High Ride I might give a 10 out of 10 to. So not a lot of songs or albums or anything is going to get a 10 out of 10 for me. That doesn't mean it's not, you know, fantastic. It doesn't mean there's anything wrong with the song. You know, just because Someone to Save has a 9 out of 10 doesn't mean it's not a great song. It just didn't shift my perspective on music in any way, right? So it's a really high standard, but it's not perfection or anything like that. It doesn't need to be perfect to get a 10 out of 10. But anyway, that's the list. There are some thoughts on it. I won't go too deep into it. If you haven't heard some of those songs, a song like Make a Wave is probably a little more low-key, so maybe you haven't heard that one. Another song on here worth checking out could be Code Green, No Losing by Prince Bangle featuring Mayday. Man, that song was almost... That song would have been like a probably a strong... somewhere between 8 or 9 out of 10. It would have been in the top 5. But it just... it comes up short. But check out the song. It's worth checking out either way. Yeah, that's it. That's the segment. This is the list. Let me know if you have any ideas for other segments. You can hit me up in the Discord or on Instagram. I'll share my Instagram right now. It's Spencer from Earth. Twitch. I have this link for... if you want advice, suggestionox.com/r/my2spence. You can ask for advice or commentary on anything you'd like, or you can hit me up on Instagram or Discord or wherever you can find me. Let me know your feedback. Let me know what you think about these this number system too. Is this number rating? I have mixed feelings on number ratings. Are you you like this kind of system? Do you absolutely hate it and I should switch to something else? Let me know all the thoughts and feedback. All right. Thanks, y'all. Have a good week. Love you. See you next time.
Oh, thank you, Spencer. We appreciate that. Thank you for putting my work on display and judging it. Every time I got to make a song now, I got to fucking blow Spencer's mind. You know what I'm saying? I got to make some Inception level shit. You know what I mean? Like, I gotta really make him question his own reality with every fucking song. I saw a video today of... Anthony Fantano, who's like a famous reviewer of music. He basically, I guess, Logic, the rapper Logic, you guys heard of him? So he basically made a video like kind of poking fun and like reviewing a review that Anthony Fantano did of a Chance the Rapper album. And it was funny watching him break, like Anthony Fantano break down Logic's review of his review. It just made me realize like how unaffected and insensitive 95% of the time I feel like I personally am when it comes to people's subjective reviews of our music. I think it's just because I've been doing it a long fucking time and really like I just understand the subjectivity of music, and it never really, I don't know, like this, not only is it just really about your perspective, each person's individual perspective, what I may like, you may not like, and so on and so forth, but then people just change as well. So like people will love a track and in that particular point in their life, they'll love a song, but then 5 years later, they'll listen back to that song and that song won't have the same effect. Song is still just as good. Song still has the same fucking like lyrics and everything is the same, but the person changes over time. You know what I mean? So I just started to really process that over all these years of making music and realizing like there's just nothing you can do about that. You know what I mean? Like nothing. The only time that really like some shit will really get me is if somebody makes a comment on something constructive, like a constructive comment on something like that I'm doing on a record or whatever that I feel is like valid, that hurts. You know, I'm like, oh damn, like if they say something specific about like a lyric or a cadence or a whatever, then that's when it stings me a little bit. But these days, most of the time, I'm cool. Bring it on, hate all you want. Give me the ones and the twos and the threes and the whatever. Nah, but I always try to take positive, constructive criticisms out of anything that anybody ever fucking says. Me and Burns used to talk all the time about reading comments online, and he was like the I don't ever read comments thing. I mean, he will sometimes, but he's like the normally he strays away from reading comments, and I'm like the I fucking read every fucking comment. Like I'm like Aziz Ansari when he says like, no, I got all the time. I got you. You may think I may not have time for that, but I got time for that. I'm here to read all the comments, and. I don't know. I try to pick good shit out of everything. Even if somebody says I fucking am trash, I just go, okay, I wonder why they think I'm trash. Interesting. Okay. And try not to let it affect really like who I am as a music maker, as a person. You know what I'm saying? Either way, thank you, Spencer, for the review. really what you said and looking at your list made me realize I just got to do more records this year. I really got to drop more shit. And I got to blow your fucking mind. The goal is a 10 out of 10. We got to at least get one 10 out of 10 for 2023. Like, shit. My next song is going to be very avant-garde. It's going to be bleeps and bloops and no lyrics and shit. Especially like, this is fucking amazing. It's blowing my mind. Fight Club. All right. All right. Here, let's do this. We have a breakdown request. It came in a little choppy from Mr. Ryan Rednose out in, I forget exactly where you're at now, but let's see. This came in a little choppy, but let's see if we can make out what it is that Ryan wants us to break down this week.
Hello, Rick. Ryan here, Asheville, North Carolina, rapping. I'm a quiet guy. I've been around a long time. Work strange. Love the music. Just, I thought about a breakdown I wanted to hear. Afterglow, man, that track right there goes so hard. But I've never really understood exactly how it came to be. I know Nom's, I think Nom's produced it, but I don't know. I like to hear about it. So, as always, love you, bro. I'm always the quiet one. Nobody ever knows where I'm going to be at, when I'm going to pop in. But I'm always here. I'm always listening. Y'all stay up. Love you, fam.
Appreciate the request, Ryan. Of course, we will oblige. It's time to break down Afterglow.
You said that you would be here. For so long I knew you were. Now none of this don't seem fair. Calling you to serve. This house is not as full now. An emptiness occurs. I don't know where to be now. It's all somewhat a blur. It's all somewhat a blur. They said we'd be forever. I never thought they'd lie. I never thought they'd lie. I must have been naive to think that we could just outlive the ones who die. Down, down, deep into the darkness, where most of us don't go. Where most of us don't go. I'll keep a light on just in case you come around and wanna whisper to my soul. Wanna whisper to my soul. Oh, I'm looking for you after the glow. Take you to the place now where we'd go to be alone. They'll never really place how our bond was made of stone. Our bond was made of stone. It's stronger now than ever. I thought that it was broke. I thought that it was broke. It looks like we can spend it all together now. The time, where does it go? Tell those other cynics that you won't be going back. You won't be going back. And each and every visit, I'll be here to tell you that. I'll be here to tell you that. I'm looking for you after. You after the glow.
Damn. Took me back with that one. Yeah, apparently we did break that down on this show already.
Get the fuck out of here.
Episode 22. I fucking forgot. Actually, it's funny when I listened to Ryan's breakdown request. I hadn't taken it out of the folder, but I thought it was a repeat. And I was like, didn't we break that down already? But I couldn't find the Excel sheet that Gia sent me with the breakdowns, and it wasn't in my notes. So I was like, you know what? Fuck it. I just wanted to hear it. And I did have a little shadow of a doubt, I swear. Please believe me that I thought we might have covered it already. But because I remember telling the story, but I've told the story to a few people before. Either way, we're going to break it down real quick for the new folks. But just so you know, we did this already in episode 22. Sorry and shit. Sorry, that's my fault. It's my fault. I gotta get Gia's list back so I can make sure I don't double back over myself again. Either way, what ended up happening was, for those who don't know and haven't heard the story, Anonymous sent me that track. He has a lot of really dope music that hasn't been released on DSPs yet. He's done a few different side projects. He's got a side project with Rudy Goblin. He's got a side project with Felix, who used to play live with us, called Phenoms, which is on the DSPs. And then we did that record. He sent me that beat, and I really loved it. He said he had envisioned me on it, and right around the time that he sent it to me, a very old friend of mine that I went to high school with, her mother passed away, and I went up to Hollywood and went to her mother's funeral, her memorial, and I was there, and it was the first memorial, funeral, anything of that nature that I had been to in a very long time. I had been lucky to not have to go to any of those for quite some time. And when I was there, I was kind of soaking in all the reactions, the energies, the things people were saying. I went by myself. My wife couldn't go that night, so I drove up and just kind of like went there by myself. And I bumped into a bunch of high school friends, of course. And it was just a very like surreal experience, you know what I mean? It was just very different from anything I ever do in my normal daily life. And when I was there, what are those cards called? When they give out the cards at the funerals or memorials, it's like not commencement. There's a name for it. I can never fucking remember the name of these things, but they have these cards that they give out at memorials or funerals. And it'll say like a poem or something like about the person. And this one had a little write-up, a poem inspired by my friend's mother. And it was called Afterglow. Afterglow was the name of the piece. And it's not a memoriam. There's another name for it. I cannot think of the fucking name. I can never remember the name. I gotta look it up when this show's over. But it's like on the tip of my tongue. I can't think of it. Either way, so when I saw the word Afterglow, it just stuck with me. And then the feelings of watching my friend mourning her, the loss of her mother, stayed with me for the next, I don't even remember how long it was. But when I went to write the next time, I had that track from Noms, and I had all those memories from that experience, and Afterglow just stuck with me. So I went in and wrote that basically really for her, but also for anyone who's just lost someone or feels disconnected from someone or separate from someone. So that's why I didn't really go too specifically on like death itself or, you know, saying anything too specific, because I wanted it to work for what I had seen with her, and I wanted it to work for her, but I also wanted it to work for anyone who's just been separated or lost somebody, you know. Yeah, it's like a prayer card. There's a word. It's like not a prayer card, not a remembrance card. Remembrance card kind of sounds kind of familiar. Like commission, no. Requiem, no. Ah, man, it's like there's a word that I'm thinking. Maybe it is remembrance card or prayer card. Yeah, it might be. It might be. Well, either way, so that is how we got Afterglow. And for those who are saying it in the chat, I agree. I've been talking to Noms recently, and we need to get that song on DSP. So I'm going to make a play to put that, because there's really no reason at this point that it shouldn't be on DSPs available to stream for anyone, anywhere, at any time. So look out for Afterglow, hopefully coming very soon to a DSP near you. All right. Thank you, Ryan, for requesting that breakdown, even though, yes, I know we did it already. Sorry. Shit. All right, let's do some lines. You guys came with it. I told you last week that Denny was the only one to set off the new episode with the lines. You guys came with it, though. You brought some lines in, and I appreciate it. Let's see who is out there in GTFOH Nation. Let's do a line.
What up, Wreck? This is Sammy Vargas from Kansas City, and I just want to say the podcast is great. I love listening and watching it every week, and keep on going, homie. Going all the way to the top. All right, and I just want to tell everyone else that's not been listening in, get the fuck out of here.
Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, Sammy. Sammy Vargas III in Kansas City, KCMO. Congratulations to the Kansas City Chiefs. I saw the Super Bowl parade was looking crazy. Tech was out there performing Red Kingdom. I saw all my KC family out there, fire. Everybody was having a good time. I don't know if you went to the parade, Sammy, or if you're into football, but congratulations to the Kansas City Chiefs. And thank you for listening, Sammy. You know I love me some KC. Shout out to all my Kansas City family. It's on the fucking right. All right, let's see who else we got out there real quick. Let's see. Let's do another line.
Hey, I wanted to give a shout out. This is X Addict. I wanted to give a get the fuck out of here to the dude that stole the Frito-Lay's truck and almost fucking rammed me off the highway. Damn. on my way home back from work at fucking 6 o'clock in the morning. And I'm not gonna lie, I was smoking a joint, driving, listening to some Mayday, man, and saw the cops behind me, thought I was screwed. Well, next thing you know, I pull over in the shoulder and a Frito-Lay's truck flies by me doing like 80 fucking miles an hour and almost kills me. Whoever stole that Frito-Lay's truck, dude, yeah, get the fuck out of here, bro. You could have picked something way fucking better.
Damn.
Get the fuck out of here.
Wow. Ex-addict. All right. Yeah, send him a GTFOH stamp for stealing a Frito-Lay truck and almost running off the road. They could have stole something better. Could have stole a Kia Sophia or something a little faster. Frito-Lay truck, not that discreet.
Get the fuck out of here.
Let me fucking find out. All right. Thank you, X-Addict. Appreciate you. And yes, GTFOH to that motherfucker right there for almost running you off the fucking road. Okay, I got to let you guys know for a split second. I fucked up. Once again, on this show, I fuck up quite regularly. It happens. I just got to let you guys know that... Oh, this is going to be difficult for me, though. Hold on a second. In season 2... And season 1, for that matter. No, it was in season 2. I brought up a snack that people made that was a little bit suggestive, and it was called candle salad. Okay? Candle salad. You guys remember candle salad?
Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, so candle salad was... I was trying to work it in as many episodes as I could in the previous season, and we never did a finale episode. You know what I'm saying? So I left you guys hanging. You never really got to know how much damage we did in terms of candle salad. Because now it's season 2023. That's right, Gridlock. It's not season 3. Season 2023. So my man Circle Pit Mike has some stats for us so we can get some closure.
And y'all thought I was done. And now for the moment you've all been waiting for.
Oh, thank you, God.
The candle salad numbers.
Yes.
So we have had 31 total mentions of candle salad.
31.
7 total consecutive episodes.
Okay.
The most times you've said it in an episode was episode 56, Retrograde, which was also the first appearance of candle salad.
Good times.
And the second most times you said it was in the most recent episode, 62. So, yeah. There's the candle salad stats. Peace out.
Candle salad. Circle Pit Mike. Thank you. Thank you, Mike. Oh, I feel complete. I feel whole. candle salad, for those who are not in the know from our previous episodes, candle salad, I wish I should just have a picture of it to drop in here at any moment. Candle salad was an old school meal that, or not a meal, like a snack, I guess, that they used to make in the 50s. And it was basically like a banana with a, like, on top of a bed of lettuce with like some cherries and like a, was it pineapple, I think, or something like that? And it was like a snack that people made, and like women would get together and make it. But it looked like a dick and balls.
Get the fuck out of here!
It basically looked like a plate of dicks on a bed of lettuce. It was a very suggestive looking snack. And when I basically read the story about candle salad, I said, oh, I bet you I'm just going to like watch how many times I work candle salad into an episode. And I wasn't just saying candle salad randomly like I had Tourette's. I was really working that shit in to the episodes with like proper segues and making it make sense. You know what I'm saying? Google candle salad if you have no idea what the fuck I'm talking about. And just look at a picture of candle salad and you'll know. And then maybe try and make one this weekend. Have a candle salad. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, next Super Bowl party next year, just have candle salad for everybody. Don't do wings. That's old school. Do candle fucking salad. Let's go. Candle salad.
Get the fuck out of
here. We're back, baby. Oh, man. All right. We're about to wrap it up. I think we got a couple more lines before we get the fuck up out of here. Let's make sure. Oh, come on now. We got to get the Dolly Gagne in this bitch. Dolly Gagne, let's do a line. Let's see what's up.
What up, GTFO Nation? Gagne here. Wanted to wish all those people, whether you're single, dating, engaged, married, or it's complicated, a happy Valentine's Day. Shout out to all the crew, couples, and shout out to my wife, very special and dear to my heart, both my daughters. I hope you all have an amazing Valentine's Day. If you're single, wear that smile highly and proudly. You never know who's watching you. If you're engaged or married or it's complicated, remind them of how special they are to you and enjoy the day. Gagne out.
Mr. fucking Gagne.
Get the fuck out of here.
Tony writes the Dolly Gagne. Sweet Princess is laughing about let's do a line in the chat. I got to let you guys know that I got berated for Let's Do a Line in the first season when we first launched this show. I used to have a sound effect. I'm just doing it now on the mic because I don't have it anymore. But I used to have a sound effect of somebody like sniffing and I would be like, let's do a line, because I thought it was, I don't know why, for some reason it was just comical to me. And I got, somebody was teared into my ass. I can't remember who it was now, but somebody really was offended by the fact that I was calling it Let's Do a Line. And I was like, yo, I'm not the cocaine city councilman. All right. I'm just joking around for real. Relax. What the fuck? I just thought it was funny, like, turn of phrase. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, that's okay. I kept doing it. If you don't know, it's my show and I do whatever the fuck I want.
Get the fuck out of here.
That's all right. I do what I want. Whatever. Some people say that candle salad looks scrumdiddlyumptious. Anyway. All right, so if you want to leave me a line for this show, if you want to tell somebody in your life to get the fuck out of here, you want to just like, or you just want to tell me something ridiculous that happened to you, or you want to give me a shout out or say something about the music or whatever it may be, you can do one of two things. You can either check out the description of this show and check out the link, the anchor link, to leave a voicemail. That link will let you leave a voice message up to 1 minute. All right. After 1 minute, it's going to cut your ass off. So don't be rambling. Or if you'd like to get a little bit more funky with it, you can record a voice memo on your phone and email it to me at thegtfohpodcast@gmail.com.
Get the fuck out of here.
All right. That's how you leave a line for this show. So if you want to do a line with me, all right, suggestively, you can do that. Please do it. For tonight, episode number 64, I have one last line that randomly got left with no context whatsoever, but this is just the kind of guy he is. I went on tour with this guy. He sold merch for us. He's an epic individual, and he left us this gem.
Man walks into a bar. He looks at the bartender and says, give me 3 shots, 1 whiskey, 1 bourbon, and 1 tequila. Bartender looks up for a second and says, damn, what are we celebrating? Man says, my very first blowjob. Bartender says, well, shit, let me fucking pour you one, too. The man said, no thanks. These don't get the taste out of my mouth. Nothing will.
Get the fuck out of here.
Norman Penberthy. The fourth, I think, or something. Or my guy, Norm. There you go. He left it for us. He just had to leave it, close it out on that note. Fuck it. All right, Norm, we see you, bro.
Get the fuck
out
of here.
Sure, why not? It's our first blowjob joke. Well, not our first blowjob joke, but it's like our first actual joke, like Waka Waka joke. You know what I'm saying? All right, that's a great fucking place to end it if you ask me. You know what I'm saying? Episode 64, Dog Shit Alley. Thank you so much for tuning in, guys. It's been a pleasure. I appreciate you. If you're listening to this on an audio platform like Spotify or Apple Podcasts, please rate the show. Give us 15,000 million stars. Drop a comment on how much you love the show and how it's like a 10 out of 10 on Spencer's fucking change your life scale. All right. If you're on YouTube, give us a thumbs up on the video and drop us a comment and all that shit. Subscribe to the channel and please do whatever you can to help support the show. I think you're able to subscribe to this show on podcast platforms yet, but I don't even know really for sure, so it is what it is. We'll figure it out at some point. I appreciate you guys for tuning in. Shout out to all my fucking Wrekin' Crew family. It's only right. You guys are the truth. Without you guys, I wouldn't be doing none of this shit. So if you're a member of the Wrekin' Crew, patreon.com/Wrekonize, you are the reason why we're here still making shit happen, and I appreciate each and every single one of y'all. I will see you guys next week. I'm going to be back on schedule, so streaming Tuesday night at 10 p.m. Eastern on Twitch, and the podcast should go up between Tuesday night and Wednesday morning. So I appreciate you guys. Thank you so much for tuning in, and I think there is only one other thing we can do, which is play the song.
It's that time again. We gotta say goodnight. You know it's getting late. Tomorrow is another day, my friend.
All right, people. Time to go home. Yep. Losing time. We're ready to head on out. So let's go.
You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. Now you're making me mad. You're gonna make me swear.
Get the fuck out of here. Finish up that beer.
You might as well call it a night, my friend. You're gonna have to
get the fuck out.
You heard me. So long, arrivederci, sayonara.
Get the fuck out.
Ciao, good night.
Bye bye, so long, farewell.
See you later, alligator. In a wild crocodile shaking now. Get the fuck out.
Get the
fuck out of here. Come on, give me a fucking break.
Can I get a refill, please?
Hey, you fuckface, get out of here. What do you fucking
get? Get the fuck out.
Yeah, you.
The GTFOH Podcast. Learn more at thegtfohpodcast.com.
Just what the world needed, one more podcast.
Get the fuck out of here.